was at St. Jude when the institution turned its focus to molecular biology, revolutionizing the technologies being used in our basic science departments and ultimately giving way to what we do today. I was trained as a sort of firm believer in the concept that basic science would spawn clinical activity and ultimately maybe even be important in curing disease. And it was in the context of receptor signaling that we discovered cyclin D1. And 7 years later, they tested the drug, and the drug was finally FDA approved in the mid-2000s. St. Jude has always invested in research. It's always invested in basic science, always, from the beginning. And also allowed us to recruit other people who, like us, were pushing the technologies forward.
I am Babis Kalodimos. I'm the chair of structural biology department here at St. Jude. We have a number of very powerful magnets, very unique, and that allows us to basically explore and tackle very unique biological questions that other researchers cannot do. In structural biology, we made the decision to invest heavily into building here the best NMR center in the world. This technology plays a critical role in one of the most important projects, I would like to say, currently in basic science, which is the blue sky on seeing the invisible in protein kinases. What is unique about the structural biology here at St. Jude is that we encourage researchers to go after this high-risk, high-reward kind of projects we have here. We have the best resources that anyone can find, and I hope to be at St. Jude when finally our magic has worked in seeing the invisible conformational states in protein kinases, how these states underpin cancer, and then how we can use this information to develop new cures for cancer.
I was at St. Jude when cranial irradiation was removed from standard risk ALL. It helped advance precision medicine and allowed us to focus on survivorship. Total 15 was a study that involved patients with acute lymphoblastic leukemia that relied on genetics, trying to provide precision of care and reducing patients' relapse. My role with Dr. Pui, who was the principal investigator of the protocol, I was his nurse practitioner throughout the protocol. He wanted to see what he could do to make the lives better of the patients and took the risk of promoting to take radiation out of the protocol. Removing radiation was so important to the patients at St. Jude, and now the world takes that lead as they saw that 94% of the patients with ALL survived this without that needed type of treatment.
Diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma, or DIPG, is a devastating childhood tumor that arises in the brainstem, found almost only in kids, and is essentially incurable. So this is a really important tumor for the mission here at St. Jude and for children all around the world. And we started this by trying to understand the genetic mutations in these tumors and identified very unexpectedly one specific mutation that's found in 80% of these tumors. So St. Jude is an amazing place to do brain tumor research because we have great clinical trials that bring patients from all over the country, sometimes other parts of the world. These are very rare brain tumors. And so my group and Martine Roussel's group have been working to take that tissue and develop them into models that can be used for research and shared with other labs. My hope for DIPG research is that the incredible acceleration in progress will continue and offer hope to patients and their families. I hope this is coming soon. I hope I'm still here at St. Jude to see that day.
I was at St. Jude when we started St. Jude Global, which is the continuation of the dream of Danny Thomas, that no child should die in the dawn of life anywhere. For the first 6 decades of the history of St. Jude, we have worked to advance cures We have brought the cure rates from, say, less than 20% to more than 80 or 85% today. Now the question is, how can we take this to every single child around the world? To get that deep, we realized that we needed to influence the way the hospitals work, to influence the way the governments work at a national level, and most importantly, we needed to change the world.
I think one of the most recent examples of the importance of these collaborations that we have with partners globally was the Safer Ukraine initiative. As many of you know, in February, Russia invaded Ukraine, and that has caused a lot of issues, both directly from the war, but then indirectly from the disruption of medical care. And so we've had partnerships in Ukraine, and when the war started, they asked our help to evacuate initially a few patients, and then those few patients turned into many patients, over 1,000 patients and their families that have been supported to seek care outside of the country. So one of the things that I think this program has done is to give families the chance to not only reach physical safety, but really to continue that high quality medical care for their child and give them a chance of hope for the better outcome. That sharing of knowledge across different institutions, across different countries is exciting to be a part of, but also I think elevates the care that we provide to our patients every day as well. I really hope to be here when children with cancer have access to the best quality care, no matter where they live.